before Hilton Head was named the number one island in the U.S. by readers of Condé Nast Traveler magazine for 4 years in a row, it was the number one target of the U.S. Navy. And before D-Day, the number one site of the largest amphibious landing by American forces anywhere in the world. It was 160 years ago this week, November 7th, 1861, the day of the big gun shoot, the Battle of the Port Royal Sound. It's a day that pretty much changed Hilton Head and Beaufort County forever. It revolutionized naval warfare and signaled huge political, economic, and social changes for the whole country. I'm Chris Haro with Keller Williams Realty. This area where I live is way more than just great beaches. There's all kinds of incredible history here in the Hilton Head area, if you know where to look. In this case, we're looking at one of those great beaches, the north end of Hilton Head Island, in a private gated community of Port Royal, one of the most exclusive oceanfront neighborhoods in Beaufort County. The same place as so many unbelievable multi-million dollar properties tipped off the most complete redistribution of property ownership in Hilton Head's history. And one of Hilton Head Island's most peaceful beaches was also the site of its most brutally violent day on record. Little backstory, less than a week after the Battle of Fort Sumter in Charleston, the Union announced a blockade of southern ports as part of a strategy to isolate Confederate states in hopes of bringing the Civil War to a quick end. The problem was, Confederate states had over 3,000 miles of coastline where trade and supplies from overseas could help their war effort. And the ships needed to enforce a Union blockade were all scattered and all hundreds of miles north. A South Atlantic blockade would require all those ships and more, coaling stations, repair docks, supply depots, and lots of provisions. For the blockade to work, they had to take a southern port, a big one. And while the potential targets were being studied in Washington, D.C., in New York, Philadelphia, and Annapolis, South Carolinians like Brigadier General Thomas Fenwick Drayton, a South Carolina native, West Point graduate, and one of Hilton Head's most prominent landowners, didn't really need a map to know where the Union would go looking for their port. Not Charleston Harbor, not the Savannah River. Those larger cities were well defended, easily reinforced, and directly supplied by the Charleston and Savannah Railroad lines, of which General Thomas Drayton was president. So, in those early days of the Civil War, both sides put their attention here, the deepest natural harbor south of New York, the Port Royal Sound, directly accessible to the Atlantic, but surrounded by remote sea islands, which made it both critically vulnerable for the South and urgently valuable to the North. In the spring of 1861, as Union shipyards scrambled to retrofit merchant ships and build 90-day gunboats to attack and hold the deepwater base for their blockade, Confederate forces scrambled to build two forts, one for each side of the wide entrance of the Port Royal Sound. One on Bay Point, Phillips Island, called Fort Beauregard, and another here on Hilton Head, called Fort Walker. Both forts would be under the command of Thomas Drayton. His Fish Hall plantation became his headquarters for the island's defense. The walls of Fort Walker were constructed just down the road from his family home, on land that had been in his wife's family for almost 100 years. On October 26th, the front page of the New York Times reported that the great naval expedition had started on its secret mission. The paper detailed the disposition of the Army and Navy forces, names for the ships, their armaments, the number of men aboard, officers' names, and their likely targets. Front page, top secret mission. Even without the high-profile press coverage, it's hard to imagine much element of surprise for a fleet of over 70 ships leaving Hampton Roads, Virginia the next day, carrying horses, weapons, wagons, soldiers, sailors, and Marines, in the largest U.S. naval expedition of the century and heading south to attack and capture a hostile shore defended by two newly built, deeply entrenched fortifications where everybody knew they were coming. In the 1860s, attacks from the sea onto land-based targets faced terrible odds, contending with storms, winds, swells, and tides. Even if the attacking ships didn't run aground on a hidden sandbar, they would be out in the open, navigating in enemy territory, easy targets for entrenched land-based guns. The disadvantage was so extreme, conventional wisdom held that it would take five guns on water to match one gun on land. The fleet's lead ship, the Wabash, had steamed out of the Verrazano Narrows with 50 cannon on board. Forts Walker and Fort Beauregard were estimated to have the same number of cannons, 50 cannon between them, effectively a 5-to-1 advantage over the strongest ship in the Union fleet. The Union forces also included thousands of soldiers, sailors, and Marines from Maine, New Hampshire, Connecticut, Massachusetts, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Michigan, and South Carolina. Included on the published list of the naval officers leading this not-so-secret expedition was the captain of the USS Pocahontas, Commodore Percival Drayton. Percival was the younger half-brother of Brigadier General Thomas Drayton, who was in charge of the Confederate forts under attack. Not only would Thomas Drayton have the Union fleet at his doorstep, his brother Percival would be with him, firing on his older brother and his nephew, Lieutenant William Drayton, as well as their family home. November 7th, 1861. At 8 a.m., the USS Wabash gave the signal to weigh anchor. Two lines of ships followed the Wabash as it entered the uncertain waters of the Port Royal Sound. The first shots were fired by Fort Walker at 9:26 a.m. The Wabash turned away from Fort Walker and steamed north, opening up its guns on Fort Beauregard before turning back, cruising out of range of Beauregard's guns, reloading, and firing on Fort Walker. Then turned again, completing a circular path around the sound, and fired on Fort Beauregard again. A line of Union ships fell in behind the Wabash, approximating this course in parade laps up and down the sound. Each ship was only in range of land guns for a matter of minutes, while both forts received barrages of cannon fire at point-blank range, 600 yards or less, in what was described as a hailstorm of iron. Reporters from New York counted 40 shell bursts in one pass, falling as fast as horses' feet beat the ground on a gallop, plus crossfire from the Pocahontas. The bombardment continued for 5 hours until both forts were silenced and abandoned. Combined casualties were proportionately small by Civil War standards, but severe by almost any other. At least 100 wounded and over 60 dead. More than 12,000 Union soldiers and Marines came ashore with little resistance. The Stars and Stripes were raised over Fort Walker that afternoon and over Fort Beauregard the next morning. All members of the Drayton family survived the battle. Percival was promoted. Thomas and William retreated with Confederate forces to the mainland, losing all family property on Hilton Head. Thomas Drayton's personal home on Hilton Head became headquarters for the Union's South Atlantic blockade and the Union Army's Department of the South. News spread quickly that steam-powered boats, coordinated with ground troops, had managed to capture fixed land-based forts in a single day. A year later, the South Atlantic blockade had cut Confederate shipping activity by 85%, but it failed to bring a quick end to the Civil War. As part of the Port Royal experiment, hundreds of Hilton Head slaves, many of whom were undoubtedly forced into building the two Confederate forts, would now build something of their own. A small, self-governed town in a cotton field of Drayton's former plantation. In their town, they voted and elected officials. We built a church and a school believed to be the first compulsory school in the South. The town was called Mitchellville, and it was just over there across the marsh. There, they would be among the first to receive news of the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. Although it's almost invisible from the water, the Fort Walker site still exists, and it's an everyday part of the Port Royal neighborhood here to explore on Hilton Head. And again, the site of Fort Walker is on private property within a gated community. It is not open to the public, but the Port Royal Sound and its history certainly are. To learn more about the Battle of Port Royal Sound, check out the amazing book by Michael Coker. Visit the Hilton Head Historical Society and Heritage Library, or you could take a guided tour through Hilton Head's Coastal Discovery Museum.